Today's video covers probability and probability distributions through purely visual means. And so leaving this video, you should be able to understand what a random variable is, the concept of a probability mass function, a cumulative distribution function, as well as a probability density function. And so let's jump right into these four topics. Let's start off our conversation with discussing the idea of rolling a die. And when I roll a die, there are a series of outcomes that are possible, each of which has an associated probability. And so the idea of rolling a die is a good example of a random variable. It's simply some random phenomenon that can be represented by numerical values. And so if I roll a die, it can take on a value between 1 and 6, and there's some uncertainty around what the outcome will be. Now, to represent the probabilities associated with those different outcomes, that's where a probability mass function comes in. And so a probability mass function simply is a mathematical representation to highlight the probabilities associated with the different outcomes that a random variable can take on. And so the way that this probability mass function will look like is that on the x-axis are the different outcomes that this particular random variable might take on. And on the y-axis, we show the different probabilities associated with those outcomes. And so in the example of rolling a die, there are going to be 6 outcomes that this particular random variable can take on. And we usually weight each one of those outcomes with a probability of 1/6. Now, if you studied probability and heard that a probability mass function is associated with discrete random variables, hold that thought. We'll come back to that in a second. But now you should know what a random variable is, as well as a probability mass function. The third item I want to introduce now is the idea of a cumulative distribution function. Similar to a probability mass function, we have a plot where we're plotting probabilities on the y-axis, and on the x-axis, the outcomes for the random variable. However, unlike a probability mass function, where we're simply plotting the probabilities associated with each one of these outcomes, in a cumulative distribution function, we are plotting the probability that this random variable will take on a value less than or equal to that outcome of interest. So let's see what this looks like in the example of rolling a die. One way to visualize what's happening in the cumulative distribution is that we're running a sliding window across a probability mass function and simply adding up the probabilities associated with each outcome that our window passes by. So up until the outcome of 1, the cumulative probability, the cumulative distribution function, should be equal to 0. And that is because it's impossible for us to roll a die and have the outcome be less than 1. Now, when we hit the value 1 with our sliding window, what is our new estimate of the cumulative distribution function? It should be 1/6. In other words, there is a 1/6 chance of the outcome less than or equal to 1. Now we can continue sliding our window, and up until the outcome of 2, all outcomes have a 0 probability set to them. And so the cumulative probability remains at 1/6. And when we hit the value 2, there is now a jump again in our cumulative distribution to 1/3. There is now a 2/6 chance of the outcome less than or equal to 2. And I can continue this process. The cumulative distribution remains constant up until the outcome 3, where again it jumps up to 1/2. And I repeat this process, running the sliding window across the outcomes for the probability mass function, summing them up and mapping that to the cumulative distribution function. And notice that the cumulative distribution function ends at 1. There is a 100% chance that when I roll the die, the outcome will be less than or equal to 6. In fact, there is a 100% chance that it'll be less than or equal to 7, less than or equal to 8, or any other outcome that goes beyond 6. And that highlights a really key aspect associated with the cumulative distribution. It is by definition going to be bounded between the values of 0 and 1. So we've introduced the concept of a random variable, the idea of a probability mass function, and the concept of a cumulative distribution function. And we've applied this to the case of rolling a die. Now, everything that we discussed was applied to the case of a discrete random variable. A discrete random variable is simply one that has a finite amount of outcomes that are possible. For rolling a die, there are 6 finite outcomes that might occur. If I were to flip a coin, again, that's a random process, there would be 2 associated outcomes. Discrete random variables make a lot of sense intuitively. But in many contexts, the random variable might be continuous, meaning that the number of outcomes that might occur might not actually be countable. If a random variable is not discrete, we view it from the perspective of a continuous random variable. And for continuous random variables, we rely on this concept of not a probability mass function, but a probability density function. And a probability density function you have likely seen before, but it lacks the intuition that underlies the probability mass function that we saw for discrete random variables. And so the technical way you want to view a probability density function is it's a measure of probability per unit length. In this case, the length being the associated outcomes. And to determine the probability of an event of interest, we have to compute the area underneath the probability density function. Now that sounds pretty confusing, so let's just look at this graphically. So similar to a probability mass function, on the x-axis are the outcomes, and now on the y-axis is the probability density rather than the probability mass. And let's just draw here graphically the probability density function for one possible continuous random variable. And you'll see here that I drew this particular continuous random variable as a nice bell-shaped curve, which you have likely seen at one point or another. So let's choose an arbitrary outcome for this continuous random variable and map this out to an associated probability density. For this particular random variable, the outcome 3.5 is associated with a probability density of approximately 1. Now, does that mean that the probability of that outcome is 1? The answer is no, and there are a couple of ways to reason this. First, as you can see here, the probability densities for other outcomes are also greater than 0. And so if the probability densities were truly the probabilities associated with the different outcomes, we would have a significant issue because the probabilities would sum to greater than 1. The other way to reason this is that, remember, the probability density function is a measure of probability per unit length. And so at a specific outcome, the instantaneous length of it is going to be 0. And so probability per unit length multiplied by 0 will just give me 0. So in the continuous space, the way that we figure out the probability of an event is we define a range of interest, and then we can compute the probability by computing the area under this curve. Now, just like the probability mass function in the discrete case, for a probability density function, we can also compute its cumulative distribution. And the cumulative probability, once more for a random variable, is simply the probability of an outcome or less. So similar to the discrete case, the cumulative distribution will start at 0. There is a cumulative probability of 0 being less than or equal to minus infinity, and it'll gradually asymptotically approach 1. And the way that we come up with this function is we integrate across the probability density function, finding the area under the curve for each outcome. Because again, we use areas to compute probabilities. Now let's suppose that our continuous random variable, we wanted to increase the probabilities of the more extreme values as I've shown here. How would that change the shape of that underlying distribution? Well, if I wanted to increase the probabilities associated with the tails of the distribution, of course, those probability density values would go up. But note here in the center, the values would have to go down. And that's because no matter what, the area under this curve has to be equal to 1. And that's because there has to be 100% probability that an outcome for this particular random variable will occur. And so the key aspect to highlight here is for the probability density function, the peak value can be 1, it can be greater than 1, it can be less than 1. Its peak must simply ensure that the integral or the area under this curve is equal to 1. Whereas for the cumulative distribution, we know that no matter what, the lowest possible value that it can take on is 0, and the highest possible value it can take on is 1 no matter what. In probability, we frequently have seen the probability mass function and the probability density functions, but less frequently do we tend to look at the cumulative distribution. You're probably far more familiar with looking at a bell-shaped curve rather than this S-shaped looking curve that I've drawn here. But having said that, the cumulative distribution function is a really powerful mechanism for us to understand the probabilities of different events of interest to us. So to highlight this, let's look at one of our cumulative distribution functions from earlier, and let's overlay on this plot the typical notation we use in probability for the cumulative distribution. And so for a random variable x, we use lowercase x to represent the outcomes that that random variable can take on, and capital F sub x of x to represent the cumulative probability for that outcome. And so now suppose that you are asked the question by someone, what is the probability that this random variable will take on a value or an outcome less than or equal to 3? You can answer that question explicitly from the cumulative distribution function. Because again, my cumulative probability by default is the summation of all probabilities less than or equal to a given outcome. And so with this plot, what I do is I look at the outcome of interest, in this case 3, and map that out directly to the cumulative probability, and that is the probability x is less than or equal to 3. Now suppose instead somebody were to ask you what's the probability that x is greater than 3. You could also answer that question directly from the cumulative distribution function. As the cumulative distribution is simply the summation of all probabilities less than or equal to an outcome, and the probability of an outcome should be 100%, then the probability of my random variable exceeding the outcome 3 would just be 1 minus the cumulative distribution function value associated with 3. And so through the cumulative distribution function, I can figure out the probability that my random variable x is less than or equal to an associated outcome. I can also directly look at this plot and figure out the probability that it'll exceed an outcome. And furthermore, I can use the cumulative distribution function to figure out probability that I lie between a range of values, which isn't so obvious with the probability density function because remember the way to figure out the probability associated with a range is to add up the area under the curve. But you could do this quite quickly explicitly with the cumulative distribution function. So let's suppose that we're interested in the probability of lying between 3 and 4. To solve this, what we can do is compute the cumulative probability associated with the outcome 4. And remember, the cumulative probability is the summation of all probabilities less than or equal to an outcome. So now I know the probability of being less than or equal to 4, and earlier we figured out the probability of being less than or equal to 3. And so if I want to figure out the probability I lie in this range, I just take the difference associated with these two cumulative probability values. And so although we tend to be less familiar with the cumulative distribution function, it actually is a really powerful mechanism for us to answer and solve key probability questions of interest to us. And so through this primer, my hope is that there are 5 key things that you have taken away from this discussion. A random variable is some random phenomenon, whether rolling the die, whether it's flipping a coin, that can be represented by numerical values. And so for the discrete examples that I just gave, a probability mass function represents the probabilities of the outcomes that that random variable can take on. And for each of those outcomes, we can also compute their cumulative probabilities, which is the summation of all probabilities less than or equal to an outcome of interest. Now, when we have a continuous random variable, we tend to use this idea of a probability density function, but don't confuse probability density with probabilities. A probability density function is a measure of probability per unit of length, and so for an event of interest to determine the probability of it from the probability density function, we have to compute the area under the curve. And although we're far more familiar with the idea of a probability mass as well as probability density function, the cumulative distribution can really help us answer interesting questions around probability because we're able to directly extract from it the probability of specified events. We covered a lot of key content in this video visually, and so for those interested, I'll create a follow-up shortly where I explain these ideas through traditional mathematical notation. Thank you for your interest and support, and I look forward to seeing you soon.